Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Have a seat. It's great to see everybody enjoying company with each other. My name is Liz Mauch, and I am one of your elders serving on session. And I'd like to welcome you today to First Presbyterian Church Montrose. Please see announcements which are on the back of your bulletin and also in the electronic newsletters that go out from our church office. Also, the nursery is in need of one additional helper each week, and the sign-up sheet is back in the rear of the sanctuary under the clock. If you have questions, you can talk to Gania Brown. And so, this being the first Sunday of the month, this is Deacon Sunday, and on your chairs, you'll have either yellow or blue envelopes to put in the deacon offering. You may be wondering what the deacons use that money for. We have people that stop by the church office and who are in desperate need for one reason or another. Sometimes people get stranded here because they've got automobile problems. So the deacons have this fund which they can use for auto repairs, or maybe it's a need for gasoline or propane or a hotel stay. An example last week is a woman stopped by who has two of her own daughters, and then she's also raising her sisters, two kids as well. And so, you know, she's struggling to support her family. And so what she really wants is for her children to have a good start to the new school year. So they were in need of some new clothing and school supplies. So the deacons decided to go ahead and support this family's need. And on that note, it turns out that there is a need for middle school and high school student school supplies. And so the little red wagon sitting out in the hallway will be a place that you can put in some donations of school supplies. And again, middle and high school is what's needed the most. And then we have the prayer fest. We have the ongoing videos with that. If you're interested in attending the Praying Life seminar, see the back of the church bulletin for registering for that.
In the early days of the church, King Herod decided to curry favor with the Jewish authorities by attacking Christians violently. He had James, the brother of John, killed and Peter arrested. Acts 12:5 tells us that earnest prayer for Peter was made to God by the church. On the night before Peter's trial, an angel of God came to Peter in prison, broke the chains holding him, and guided him past the two sentries outside his cell and through all the gates out of the prison. Peter went from there to the house of Mary, the mother of John Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. Rhoda, a servant girl, answered Peter's knock and ran to tell the others that Peter was there. The prayer group told her she was crazy initially. They would not come to the door, saying that she was only seeing an angel, as if that itself would not be worth confirming. Finally, they came and saw that it was truly Peter. On the next day, Herod could not find Peter, and so he executed the guards and fled Jerusalem to his palace in Caesarea. There he claimed to be God and was struck down by God and died. God answered prayer for Peter, and even though those praying did not fully believe he could do it, when their prayer was answered, they almost missed it. Do we too miss God's answers to our prayers because we don't believe in our heart of hearts that he will respond to our petitions?
Please join me in our opening prayer. Heavenly and loving Father, we come before you now in worship. Quiet our busy minds. Open our ears to hear your word. Renew us, fill us with your love, so that we can be beacons of your love to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now please rise for the call to worship. For everything, there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. God has made everything suitable for its time. God has put a sense of past and future into our minds. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. Whatever God does endures forever. Let us worship God together.
Praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show your name on high.
bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love, you're slow to anger. Your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
My strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my
soul, I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name.
God,
I'll worship your holy name.
Please join me in our prayer of confession. O Holy One, now hear the assurance of pardon. Hear the good news. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. And Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone and a new life has begun. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Please join me in the prayer for our offering. Lord, we are so grateful for this day. We ask that you would bless our offering today so that it would grow your kingdom. We ask for your prayers and blessings upon our fund of deacons, that it would be bountiful to help our community, to show your hope and your name to those around us. We are thankful for all that you do. We praise your name, Lord. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from what is known as the wisdom literature. Ecclesiastes, Proverbs, the Psalms, the Songs of Solomon, or the Song of Songs. And our scripture reading this morning is from Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 14. Hear now God's word for us today. There's a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born. A time to die. A time to plant. And a time to uproot. A time to kill. A time to heal. A time to tear down. And a time to build. A time to weep. A time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search, and a time to give up, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy, to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in their toil. This is a gift from God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it, and nothing can be taken from it. God does it so that people will fear him. May God add his blessings to this, his holy word. Amen. That song you just heard became an international hit in 1965 by that American folk rock group, The Byrds. Some of you might have been part of that generation and recognize that name. And a lot of you know that that song was actually written and arranged by the legendary folk singer and social activist Pete Seeger in 1959. The Byrds took that song, infused a little peppiness, a little pop to it, and that song turned, and its lyrics shot up to the number one hit of December of that year in 1965. And those words, as you can tell, were almost taken verbatim from the King James Version of the book of Ecclesiastes. And for many of that generation, it was a clarion call to a fresh start, a new perspective on what perhaps was to come. And this song has endured the decades since it was written and sung by the Byrds. So much so that as recently in 2018, Mitch Myers of Variety Magazine wrote this about this song, and I quote, "Turn, Turn, Turn was a message of change, a message of hope, a message of acceptance, drawn from the Bible itself, a song that came to characterize the blossoming of the 1960s. It was a song whose time had come, as it was the time and the season for this song to be embraced." Life, as you know, is chock full of changes. And all of us experience it in one way or another, seasons of change. We change from childhood to adolescent, from adolescence to adulthood, and our lives are high-marked by graduations, singleness to married life, becoming parents. We've experienced job changes, and some of us had to endure, experience geographical relocations. And it's in these times of upheaval, of change, statements such as, you know, nothing is constant, or change is the new normal, or life happens, are freely given by well-meaning people. But in all seasons of change, in all seasons of transitions, there is an adjustment period. Though not all change is bad, our ability and willingness to adjust to transitions can present for some of us challenges and hurdles, can't they? New circumstances, new situations, new relationships can get us off our usual life rhythms. And depending upon the depth of the change or life experience, it can profoundly affect our outlook on life. Our natural instincts is to look back the past and hold on to or long for the familiarity and the security of once upon a time. But just like the Israelites, who complained bitterly when they left Egypt, Moses said to them in the desert, "You cannot go back to Egypt." We are currently in a sermon series in which I have entitled, "A Fresh Start, A New Journey." And last Sunday, I talked about not letting the past determine our present or our future. And so this morning, I want to talk about having the right perspective, the right attitude in the midst of all these changes. When I decided to move from San Francisco to New England in order to attend seminary, it was a super disorienting time for me. I moved from my family, my relatives, and all my best friends. I moved from a well-established relational community to a place where I knew absolutely no one. I moved from a two-season geography to a four-season geography. I moved from my much-loved West Coast culture to an East Coast New England culture. You know, I had known growing up in Arkansas that there was such thing as a Southern accent, but I had no idea there was such thing as a New England accent. And then there was something called a New England winter. For the first time in my life, I spent my hard-earned part-time job money on down booties and long johns. After that first winter, I was contemplating of transferring from Gordon Conwell Seminary in New England to Fuller Seminary in Southern California, in Pasadena, where it was warm, where it was sunny. But somehow, I survived that first winter and decided to stay and finish out my seminary studies in New England. Perhaps many of you have similar stories. Stories of long-distant moves. Stories of profound, life-changing events. And stories of reorienting to a new normal. This past week, I was filling up my small frame Filipino body with tons and tons of caffeine, meeting people for coffee just about every morning, and sometimes in the afternoon, and sometimes not even coffee, but other adult beverages. And I got to hear your stories of how you came here. I heard a story of a particular elder who she met her husband when they were young, decided out of the blue just to take their roots and just move to Colorado in their 20s. Fascinating. I heard some of you in your family life came to a point in your family life where you thought, let's adopt children. And the new normal that introduced. And I heard one particular gentleman talk about in his own life, he and his wife traveled a path in which they became foster parents and the incredible responsibility that that entails. Fascinating stories of change, of transitions, of a new normal in which for the human condition, for the human person, can sometimes introduce challenges. We all go through a myriad of transitions, and all of us have had to navigate the adjustments, challenges, and learning that come from those seasons of change. As we contemplate the reading of our scripture lesson this morning, the author of Ecclesiastes frames our lifespans with this in mind. And the author writes, there's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the sun. You know, that word season in Hebrew is a very, very rare word. You don't find it much in the Old Testament. And it is only used about three times in the Old Testament. Literally, it's translated as fitting time. Fitting time. So if we were to substitute the translation in the sentence, it would read like this. There's a time for everything and a fitting time for every activity under heaven. This idea, this notion, that there's a place, there's an order, and there's a fitting time for every activity under the heaven. That's what it wants to convey. As I read this passage this morning, my guess is that many of you resonated with the words and verbs in this biblical passage. There are words that are beautifully paint and the complex and ever-changing seasons that come with our lives. And the words on the page does not hesitate or capture the realities of our human experience by mentioning words such as kill, such as hate, such as war. The writer of Ecclesiastes doesn't flower it over, but is blunt, is authentic, and is real about our lives. Yet they're also filled with words such as laugh, dance, love. And I suspect that as you heard each words and phrases, images would come to mind. Not only would those images come to mind, but also the emotional streams that were associated with it. Also in the beginning of the passage, and particularly in verse 1 through 8, you probably picked up paired words, didn't you? Words that were opposite of each other. For example, there are paired words like born and die, weep and laugh, terror and mend, silent and speak, love and hate. The author does this intentionally. He wants to show the readers and the hearers the whole range of life experiences. In the season of embarking on a new journey and the possibility of what changes may unfold, what can these 14 verses in Ecclesiastes teach us? What are the useful lessons? What are our takeaways? What are the nuggets that we can appropriate for ourselves? First, this passage reminds us that God is the center of our world view. In hearing the order and cadence of these words in our passage, it may lead you to believe that the author of Ecclesiastes is suggesting a pessimistic or cynical or fatalistic view towards life, but nothing could be further from the truth. The author makes it clear that we can enjoy life for what it is. Life, Ecclesiastes says, is a gift from God. And as one commentator has put it, we are not in control of the times of our life, and many of the times of life can be difficult. Stability can only be found in a God-centered approach. God has imposed these limitations on us, but has put eternity in our hearts so that we might seek God out. So one can readily accept the statement, live with life as a gift from God. But I know what you're all thinking. Jesse, Pastor Jesse, life is not always good. Life is not always happy. And life is not always simple. So what happens when life is not good, not happy, not simple? What happens when we enter seasons where there's adversity, challenges, and pain? With a worldview that places God at the center, the adversity, challenges, and pain serves to shape us as a people of faith and build us up as Christ followers. Secondly, the passage reminds us that to expect unchanging happiness, contentment, or business as usual in a changing world will lead to utter disappointment. If we expect that things will never change, if we expect that what we do will always be what we will do, it is the road to ruin and the road to disappointment. And the secularism that is so pervasive in our world promotes an enticing mantra that life is all about the pursuit of fulfillment. And as one scholar has written, the author of Ecclesiastes has a powerful message for us. Fulfillment is God's business, not our business. Fulfillment is God's business, not our business. And as Christ followers, we are people of faith. And our focus is always on God. This idea captured beautifully in our Westminster Shorter Catechism when it asks the question, what is the chief aim of all human beings? And the answer to that question was this, the chief aim of all human beings is to worship God and enjoy God forever. I began this morning with my story of the big transition, the big change in my life. My family and my friends in seminary, I would have done just that. If I did not have a cadre of people who cared about me, who prayed for me, who made sure I was doing okay, I would have just told the dean, I'm done. I'm going to take the next plane back to San Francisco, and I'm never looking back. Well, my family and friends rallied, and after that, that dark season in my third year, God took me out of it. I made it through my third year. Yeah, broken. Yeah, bruised and bewildered. But I also knew that God was with me deep down. Though that year was the most difficult season of my life, the transition that I experienced shaped me profoundly. And if I ever have coffee with you, ask me about that. It shaped me profoundly, personally, and professionally. Because of that season of change, I'm a better pastor, a better listener, and I could better empathize with people who have reached the bottom of life. Because now I know, as a person that went through that my third year, now I know when one reaches the bottom of life, Jesus is still there. Jesus is still there. There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. God has made everything beautiful in its time. God has done this so that all people will worship God. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we affirm the writer of Ecclesiastes that you have made everything beautiful in its time. Everything you do lasts forever, and nothing can be added to it or taken from it. You have set eternity in our hearts, and we thank you for the promise of eternal life in Jesus Christ. Amen. My friends, join me now in the prayers of the people. Let us pray together. Almighty and ever-living God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, hear our prayers for this congregation, our community, and the world. Strengthen the faithful. Bring hope to the hopeless. And bring comfort to those with sorrow in their hearts. And Lord, we know we are a people who often worry. So gracious God, to those who are in distress, grant mercy, grant relief, and grant refreshment. And we pray for those who are feeling pain in any form, whether it's emotional, mental, or physical, or relational, and even spiritual. Loving God, we ask for your healing power. We ask that you alleviate pain where it is needed. And we pray for those that are experiencing loss of any form. Be with the grieving, cover them in your mercy and grace so that they feel supported by your divine love. Oh God, you shape our stories. May we see your grace in people's stories and in our own. We know that you use us to bring hope and peace. Give us the courage to act when called upon. So as we head into this week, grant us all the things necessary for our common life and bring us all to be of one heart and mind within your church. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we approach communion this morning, the Lord's Supper, I want us together to say the Apostles' Creed. As you know, the Apostles' Creed was developed in the 5th century, so it's a statement of faith. It is a creed that believers long before us have said together, and with one voice, of one heart, of one mind, say to one another and to the living triune God, this is who we are and this is what we believe. So let us say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. My friends, this table has been set for all those who put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And so, wherever you are, whatever your situation, whatever your circumstances, come to the table. Come to the table and be refreshed, be renewed, be released to be the person that God has called you to be. When we receive communion today, you will receive the bread. And as soon as you receive the bread, go ahead and take the bread. And there are, for those of you that wish a gluten-free option, there is a gluten-free option, a little tray in the middle. When we're ready to take the cup, let's hold the cup until everyone is served, and then we'll take the cup together. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we ask that you take these simple elements of the bread and the cup and remind us of your incredible love once again. May these simple elements help us focus on you, who loved us, who cared for us, who died for us and rose again, so that we might know you forever. In your name we pray. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus was having a meal with 12 of his best friends. And I imagine that, in my mind anyway, during that meal, his disciples were reminiscing of the incredible 3-year journey they experienced with Jesus. They remembered together how he healed a blind man, how he made a lame man walk, how he ate with the least, the lost, the last, and the lonely. And then in the middle of that meal, Jesus took the bread. He broke the bread and said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Whenever you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me." His disciples pondered his words. But it didn't really become meaningful until Jesus had rose from the dead and went back to his Father. After supper, Jesus took the cup. He raised the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood. Whenever you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." And the Apostle Paul was to later write in Corinthians, "For so often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, you, and me proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Can I have our servers please come forward?
Thank you.
the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we have eaten the bread and taken from the cup. We are called the gathered ones, but we are also called the scattered ones. So, Lord, scatter us out into your world, into our homes, our neighborhoods, our community, our town, our county, our state, and our nation. Lord, help us to be representatives of your kingdom values, that we in our own life might exude joy, grace, peace, kindness, mercy. Lord, help us and develop us to be those kinds of people. In your name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing our sending song together. Friends, hear now the benediction. In the sunlight and under the moonlight, we go in the care of a God who does not shame, inviting us to take seriously our role in building this beloved community and beyond, so we can bring to vividness our truest desires. Solidarity, kindness, compassion, and a life of gritty hope. May it be so. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, amen.